My name is Tom. I'm a National Geographic explorer and climate scientist from the UK. So clearly, I'm a long way from home. So first, I want to say thank you to all of you for welcoming me. It's a real privilege to be here in the Amazon with you today. Now, I'm a long way from home. I'm also a very long way from where I normally do my research. I can more often be found on the tops of some of the planet's highest mountains, from the Himalaya to the Andes. Now, I go to these extreme environments because, like I'm sure many of you, I am deeply concerned about the impacts of climate change. In this case, upon the stores of snow and ice in some of the planet's highest mountains. Why? Because quite literally billions of people live downstream of these high altitude stores of water. And as that snow and ice retreats, as the planet warms, the supply of fresh water is put at risk for those communities downstream. It was this concern that brought me recently to the Amazon basin. Not the Amazon as it looks out there, not the stifling heat of the rainforest. No, instead, the freezing mountaintops of the Peruvian Andes, thousands of kilometers in that direction, where, supported by local Aymaran and Quechuan communities, we climbed Nevado al Sangate, one of the tallest tropical mountains in the world. There, on the summit, almost 6.5 kilometers above sea level, we installed this weather station that you see behind me. This weather station sits and records the weather, the temperature, the winds, the humidity, the snow that falls. And the data that it collects helps us better understand the future of the water stored in the Andean mountains. That's all very well. Why am I down here now, in the heat of Manaus, sharing this with you? Well, it turns out the future of the snow and ice stored up there in the Andes is intimately tied to the future of this remarkable garden of the Amazon rainforest. This forest is not only globally significant for its role as a carbon store and for its importance for global biodiversity, it is also perhaps the world's largest pump of fresh water. The winds that travel from the Atlantic Ocean carry water with them. That water is then relayed by hundreds of billions of trees further to the west towards the Andes of Peru. The rain that falls is captured by the trees, sucked up by their roots and evaporated skyward. So the winds traveling to the Andes stay moist. They are moist as they travel up the mountain slopes. And then eventually the clouds in the Andes drop their cargo from the Amazon as snow. Snow that then over hundreds to thousands of years will creep down the mountain slopes, cracking and grinding the ground below, shaping the very mountains themselves. Eventually it creeps low enough that under the tropical sun it melts. It then begins an extraordinary journey back to the rainforest through the mighty rivers of the Amazon. So, incredibly, if you were to take a handful of water out there, it's a long way down, but if you were to climb down to the river and take some of the water, some of those water molecules would just have completed the most incredible journey. After perhaps thousands of years locked up in cold storage, they had recently arrived into the stifling heat of Manaus. Of course, some of that water never made it. Instead, it was used by the high altitude communities that depend on it to meet their freshwater needs. And when I'm up in the mountains and I'm watching the cloud roll in, like you see behind me here, this is water being pumped up from the Andes, and it's going to Calcaya here, the largest tropical ice cap in the world, been sustained for perhaps hundreds of thousands of years by the water pumped from the Amazon I worry about what would happen should this pump break. And we are seeing a devastating preview of the broken pump now in the drought that rages all around us. Now, the drought is occurring because we need three things for the pump to work well. First, we need a good supply of water flowing through the atmosphere from the Atlantic Ocean behind me. Then we need two things to relay that water across the Amazon basin to keep it moist and to allow water to rise up into the Andes. Those two things are, one, a mechanism that causes rain to fall. Two, a mechanism to evaporate that water back into the atmosphere so the air stays moist. At the moment, we do not have the normal supply of water flowing in through the atmosphere from the Atlantic because the water is unusually warm in the tropical North Atlantic, and that is deflecting some of the moist air away from the Amazon basin. We also have the very warm water off the coast of South America associated with the strong El Nino. That causes air to rise above the warm water and sink over the Amazon basin, and that cuts off the rain. Now, just imagine how much more severe the drought would be if we did not have the trees with their roots sucking up moisture from below and evaporating it skyward. Without the trees playing that role, not only would the drought be more severe, but the Amazon would be drier on average. Less water would make it from the Atlantic up the Andean slopes. The communities that depend on that fresh water would be at risk of water shortage. It is that concern that first brought this mountain scientist to the Amazon. But there is, of course, far more at stake. If this area were drier, then the trees would find it harder to grow. Fewer trees means a drier Amazon basin. I'm describing a cycle of dying and drying that is possible. And that concern is of tremendous global significance. If we were to enter into that spiral, not only would global temperatures spike because of the carbon that's released, but also with 1 in 10 of Earth's species calling this place home, the impacts on biodiversity would be profound. We're seeing a devastating preview of this now. Recently, over 100 river dolphins were killed in the boilingly hot waters of Lake Tefe. A dry Amazon is also a hotter Amazon. Without the cooling effect of water evaporating from the leaves and the forest floor, the whole basin is much warmer. If the forest were to dry and global temperatures were to keep rising, the temperatures here would climb dangerously for many species, including us. It could become too hot for the human body to safely venture outside. I'm describing a world that's frightening. It frightens me. But yet, thankfully, also one that is avoidable. The risk of this drying and dying cycle climbs with emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases. We can and we must cut our emissions quickly. We must reach net zero soon. Critically, there is also much that can be done from within the Amazon. That is why National Geographic and Rolex launched the Perpetual Planet Amazon Expedition, a multi-year science and storytelling transect of the Amazon basin. I am part of a much larger team. My colleagues and I have been working across the Amazon with local scientists and indigenous communities to help better understand the pressures on this system. From illegal gold mining in Peru to water scarcity in the Andes, to the pressures on the Atlantic mangrove forests and the threats to the river guardians in between, the Arapaima and the river dolphin, all the time trying to identify solutions to help preserve this forest. But there is one solution that is already abundantly clear. The risk of this drying and dying spiral, the risk of the pump breaking, grows with deforestation. We must, therefore, do all we can to disincentivize deforestation. That is an international responsibility. My point to bringing this message here today is that much can be done from here. The Amazon is not entirely at the whims of the international community, the decisions taken elsewhere. The future of so much can be shaped by the hands of so few within the Amazon. It is for that reason that I hope so much that we can do all we can to work together to preserve the forest that stands, so that it, in turn, can sustain so much more. Thank you.